see you sit down. Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to our panel discussion on Bangladesh. We're going to be talking about the story of Bangladesh from being a basket case, as Henry Kissinger once famously described it, to now when it's arguably a real development role model. I would like to introduce our panellists for you today. Starting from left to right, we have Professor Mutuli Nukube, who is Professor of Public Policy at the Blavatnik School of Government and also the Chief Economist and Vice President of the African Development Bank. Next, we have Dr. Gowher Rizvi, an academic who specialises in international relations and public policy and who is currently the International Affairs Advisor to the Prime Minister of Bangladesh. We then have Professor Sir Paul Collier, Professor of Economics and Public Policy at the Blavatnik School of Government, whose research focuses on international growth and development. And last but not least, we have Dr. Kamal Hossain, the architect of the Bangladeshi Constitution, and following Bangladesh's independence in 1971, served as both law minister and as foreign minister. Please join me in welcoming our panelists today. This event is in partnership with the Oxford University Bangladesh Society. So before we get started, I would like to invite the President, Mohammed Abir Hassan, to say a few words.
সবাইকে অক্সফোর্ড ইউনিভার্সিটি বাংলাদেশ সোসাইটির পক্ষ থেকে স্বাগতম ওয়েলকাম অন বিহাফ অফ অক্সফোর্ড ইউনিভার্সিটি বাংলাদেশ সোসাইটি ইটস অ্যান অ্যাবসলিউট অনার অ্যান্ড প্রিভিলেজ ফ্রম আওয়ার সোসাইটি ওয়েন বাংলাদেশ ওয়াজ বর্ন ইন 1971 উই হ্যাড ওয়ান অফ দ্য লোয়েস্ট পার ক্যাপিটাল জিডিপি ইন দি ওয়ার্ল্ড অ্যান্ড হেনরি কিসিঞ্জার ডিসমিস বাংলাদেশ সেইং দ্যাট ইটস আ বাস্কেট কেস থ্যাঙ্কফুলি দ্য পিপল অফ বাংলাদেশ ডিড নট টেক টু লং টু প্রুভ মিস্টার কিসিঞ্জার রং ইন 2015 অ্যাকর্ডিং টু দ্য ওয়ার্ল্ড ব্যাঙ্ক Bangladesh crossed the threshold for lower middle-income country. Bangladesh's success in terms of poverty reduction, female empowerment, achieving health and sanitation outcomes is remarkable. But having said that, we have a lot of problems and challenges in terms of ensuring political stability and democratic development. We think that the extraordinary journey of Bangladesh from 1971 till today has useful lessons for other developing countries across Asia and Africa. And I'm incredibly grateful that we have an esteemed panel of speakers today to discuss and reflect on these issues and these topics. I personally would like to thank President Robert and his team for making this possible. And it's a great privilege and pride for all the Bangladeshis. And finally, before ending up, I just want to dedicate today's event to all the hardworking people in the forgotten corner of the world who are struggling and working hard every day so that the lives of their future generations are a bit better. Thank you so much. Shobaike dhonnobad.
Thank you, Mohammed. So before we open the discussion up to the audience, I'm going to start off with a few questions for our panelists. And Dr. Hossain, starting with the liberation movement in 1971 and the drafting of Bangladesh's first constitution, you've played a really key role in the extraordinary journey of Bangladesh. Looking back, how would you describe that journey from 1971 right up until today?
Thank you very much, Robert. It is important to remember that our liberation struggle was a people struggle. Secure political, economic, and social justice. Upon liberation, people who were powerless subjects had been became empowered citizens and agents of change. Independence presented to us with a challenge of change. The role of the state before liberation was to secure the special interests of the ruling elites. Post-liberation, the state was intended to empower citizens and to create conditions and institutions which would provide an enabling environment for change. One of our first acts was to give ourselves a constitution in which relations between the state and its citizens were to be so defined that the state would remain under the effective control of citizens and not, as in pre-independence times, be controlled by self-serving elites. The constitution expressly proclaimed that power belongs to the people, marking the beginning of a process of actual empowerment. A working democracy was thus intended to ensure democratic participation of all citizens through their elected representatives. The goals of securing economic and social justice were spelt out, mandating that the basic necessities of life, food, clothing, shelter, education, and medical care, were to be provided to citizens through sustained economic growth. to liberate people from poverty was thus constitutionally mandated. Disparity in the standards of living between citizens was progressively to be removed. A key object was to ensure equality of opportunity to all citizens and to adopt effective measures to remove social and economic inequalities. The Constitution was thus to serve as a map for the journey which began 45 years ago. It was to provide a sense of direction and a yardstick to measure progress.
Thank you, Doctor. And Professor Nakube, Bangladesh's achievements in poverty reduction, female empowerment, and other social indicators are really quite phenomenal compared to other similar developing countries. The poverty rate has been reduced from 57% in 1990 to 25.6% in 2014. Life expectancy is now 4 years longer than in India. Infant mortality has more than halved between 1990 and 2010. What do you think are the reasons behind this incredible success?
Oh, Bangladesh has done some incredible work in enacting the right policies that have ensured this kind of progress that you have spelled out. It has met some of the tough MDG targets that have been set for it and set for the world. It's been really impressive. There's something very interesting that has happened in Bangladesh in the last 10 years. It's about how Bangladesh has harnessed what you call the demographic dividend. Basically, the demographic dividend happens when the share of older parts of the population rises faster than the share of those who are being born. So the dependency ratio moves the right way. But that's the beginning of the story. What you have to do as a country then is to invest in people, in their skills, and then move them into sectors of higher productivity. That's what Bangladesh has done. So the other thing that has happened is a typical, let me call it exploitation, if not taking advantage of the neighborhood effect. Or what you find is that Bangladesh has created a lot of manufacturing jobs in the last 10 years. In fact, the share of the manufacturing sector in the economy has grown from something like 14% 10 years ago to about 22% now. That's remarkable. And it has created a lot of jobs, manufacturing sector jobs. So it's not just about, you know, social protection in the form of access to finance, the Grameen Bank story that you all know about, or the BRAC program, which is broader. It's about creating manufacturing sector jobs and making sure that, you know, they take advantage of the neighborhood effect. There are still challenges, naturally, around infrastructure investment on the political front, dealing with climate change from time to time. But really it's about, you know, taking advantage of that demographic dividend and structural transformation, becoming a factory to the world in the same way as China did. And this is a lesson for Africa, in fact.
Thank you. And Dr. Rizvi, would you agree? Do you think that development has been primarily driven by the smart public policy decisions of the government? Or do you think it's been mainly driven by NGOs and private actors?
There's absolutely no doubt that NGOs have played a remarkable role. And the fact that NGOs have played a remarkable role also reflects the policy choices that the government made. I mean, there is no question, absolutely no question, that ultimately the success that Bangladesh has enjoyed, and I'm glad people have already put on the table the facts so that one doesn't have to rehearse it. Policy choices at the end of the day do matter. And Bangladesh realized very early in the day that governance of the society today is collaboratively produced. It is just not government's job. Government is a major player, but other societal forces, the market, the civil society organizations, NGOs, all play a role. And we made them a partner in our development endeavor. But at every stage, the reason today why we are there is because we targeted poverty. And in targeting poverty, we defined poverty not simply in terms of your money in income, but in terms of total convergence of disabilities on some sections of the people. And that is poverty of income, access to health, education, opportunities, and so forth. And once that was done, the government made a multiple intervention, because a single intervention does not work. Just improving people's income would not have worked. It comes with health, it comes with education, all sorts of other things that totality of life involves. And because the government was successfully able to do it, that Bangladesh is today showing that result. I'm almost tempted to refer to this. A couple of weeks ago, there was an interesting article in The Economist, which finally did concede all the good things that are happening. But it ended up by saying, these things have happened despite the government. No, it did not. Government policy choices are very important, and policy prescription is also very important.
And Professor Sir Paul, many developing countries in Africa and in Asia were in very similar conditions to Bangladesh in the 1980s and the 1990s. What do you think made Bangladesh the exception in terms of its reduction of extreme poverty rates and its improvement in all the other social indicators that we've mentioned so far?
Yeah, I think of Bangladesh is in a way is a sort of the antithesis of Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia got huge amounts of money from oil. That meant that any activity as humble as manufacturing or anything like that was completely uncompetitive, and so it didn't happen. And because of that, there were no jobs for the most humble people in the society, namely young women. And because there are no jobs for young women, the balance of gender power remained heavily skewed. And because of that, you've never had the demographic change that Matuli talked about. And whereas in Bangladesh, no oil, no money, one of the poorest societies on earth, competitive exchange rate, that helped enormously. That enabled Bangladesh to break in at the humble bottom of global manufacturing, around 1980, garments. I think initially one foreign manufacturer came. At the end of the 12 months, that firm was making so much money that all the workers in that factory left it and decided, we can do this, we'll set up our own. And so Bangladesh started to get a homegrown garments industry that plugged in to global markets and grew like Topsy, because that is the potential, that's the East Asian miracle. And what happened was that East Asian miracle of the relocation of activity from the industrial north to East Asia then spread to Bangladesh. And the nature of these things is that it's very clustered in particular industries, and Bangladesh has now built the biggest garments cluster on earth. Right? It is unbeatable as a garments cluster in the world. Right? And in the process, that created a lot of pretty humble jobs, but jobs. And wage jobs provide a level of security which cannot be achieved in any other way, basically. And that gave a bottom benchmark for people whose previous lives had been desperately insecure. And that improved the bargaining position of women in households. And that then led to a social revolution, which is exemplified and amplified by what Brack and Grameen did, but is demonstrated in what Matuli said, that women took the key decision into their own hands and said, we're going to reduce our fertility rate. And that then produced this huge demographic dividend. And the remarkable thing about Bangladesh, which is very unusual, is that the social impact has been bigger than the economic growth. And that's because the economic growth has been amplified by the shift in gender power. Whereas in most societies, that massive growth in jobs for women at the bottom hasn't happened, And so you haven't had that shift in the gender balance of power. Mm. Thank you.
And Professor Nakube, so do you think then that the experience of Bangladesh can be useful for other developing countries?
Oh, indeed, absolutely. You know, Africa is projected to grow its population by an additional 1 billion people. An additional 1 billion people. You heard me well. Over the next 50 years, it's going to happen. Of course, you can think this is a demographic dividend, but it isn't. It will only become one if the rate of growth of the population slows down, and then you shift the dependence ratio and invest in the young, in their skills and so forth. But also there's a lesson to learn from Bangladesh in terms of use of remittances. It's one country where remittances, there are about 8 million Bangladeshis are living outside Bangladesh. And they are sending, in 2014 alone, they're sending something like $14.5 billion. It's a lot of money. and that has been also part of the story of, you know, of cushioning people out from poverty. And just making use of that, those inflows is a good lesson for what Africa can do. At the moment, Africa has got about, is receiving something like 60 billion. That's among 54 countries. So you can see that Bangladesh, it's quite a sizable amount. I think the most that Africa receives is from Nigerians into Nigeria. It's about, 10 billion on average. So there are lessons. But there's something that I also want to amplify what Paul said about the how countries that have no natural resources can learn from Bangladesh. Every other country in Africa has natural resources, absolutely. And that's been a curse. African countries have just missed the commodity super cycle. You watch what's happening in Angola right now. Countries under pressure, Nigeria under pressure, Ghana, Gabon, Chad, everywhere. They're all rushing to the IMF, and rightly so, to get some funding to show up the macroeconomic picture and get growth going again. And so they miss that, and the lesson from Bangladesh is, you know, you can grow your economy, you can make economic progress without natural resources. But if you have them, make use of them. Maybe it's a good thing that the commodity super cycle has collapsed. Maybe, you know, these countries will think again about how to really, get structural transformation going. And another lesson is really about the jobs at the bottom. I think there's a problem in Africa that the African workers are not cheap. They're unlike those in Bangladesh. I say that because if you compare the level of their productivity relative to their wages, it's lower than that of the Bangladeshi workers. So Africa needs to kind of figure out how to have a competitive labor market. Less unionization will also be helpful as one way to attract foreign direct investment onto Africa, the same way that Bangladesh has done. There are some lessons. I think some of you may be aware of the investment that has been done by a Chinese shoe manufacturing company in Ethiopia, and they've had to invest, Huanjin, they've had to invest a lot in the skills upgrade, quite a lot, and raise productivity to a point where the Ethiopian workers are now about 80 to 90% of the productivity of their Chinese fellow workers back in China in the head office of this company, Huanjin. So it can be done, but companies have to invest in productivity, in skills, and that is Africa's challenge. But it's also a lesson for Africa to learn from Bangladesh.
Thank you. Dr. Hossain, it's not all been plain sailing, though, for Bangladesh. There have been concerns recently about the nature of democracy and political stability in Bangladesh. The main opposition boycotted the last general election. Do you think that this could jeopardise the progress that Bangladesh has made so far? And what would you suggest to try and solve these political problems?
No, thank you very much. I think this is shifting the focus to another aspect of sustainable development. You know, the sustainable development is more than just growth. I think growth is very important. Without growth, you cannot have a lot of other things that you want to achieve. But development has to be seen in terms of other goals. Before coming to that, I just wanted to supplement the remarkable achievements. I mean, I think the one sector that needs to be lauded specially are our farmers. The agricultural growth has been phenomenal. Rice production has tripled in 3 decades. This contributed to poverty reduction, and farm income became the most important single driver of poverty reduction. It accounted for half of the poverty reduction between 2000 and 2010. The government workers have already received a rich tribute from Sir Paul, but I would like to emphasize that I remember when we came in the end of the 80s, people here in Brussels and in Washington said, but you're a Muslim country and a predominantly rural country. Will Muslim women be able to come forward to this industry? I had half a dozen people representing the new industry who said they just put their head down and said, we are quite sure they will. And when we came out, we said, do you think what you said will really be borne out? Will the women from the villages really vindicate what you have said? And believe me, have they done it, and done it with a vengeance. There are now 4 million women workers. And the half a dozen people with whom I had come, there are more than several thousand entrepreneurs. Young, energetic, creative, risk-taking, developing new markets, and you know, those who said Bengalis can't do business, I mean, are having to change their views. And that Muslim women from the villages cannot be industrial workers. I mean, this is the real response, is just go through Dhaka in the, when the shift changes are there. It's a human wave. I mean, waves of women with bags on, slung on their shoulders are marching on, but at very low wages. This is where I think what you have said, and what I think our African colleagues should know, that we have yet to make sustainable development meaningful for all of our people. They're doing the production, they're increasing productivity, they're increasing export earnings. 81% of our total exports is from garments. It went up from something like 6 billion in 2004 to like 24 to 28 billion this year. So that's phenomenal, 4 times increase being done by women from the village. But are they getting the benefit of that? You know, you'd be surprised that I've been doing work protecting slum dwellers. You go there and these women come and say, but you know, we are garment workers. We are living in these slums and people are coming to evict us. Land grabbers are so greedy about grabbing urban land that the garment workers are living under constant threat of eviction. And they say, but we're willing to pay money. And you know, they're earning these billions of dollars for us, but urban housing for even workers like garment workers is an imperative that we have to, a social imperative that needs to be addressed as a matter of priority. Then about the overseas remittances, you have heard of, I don't need to say anything more about that, but the question you raise is right. You see, sustainable development has been now elaborately identified in last year's UN Summit on Sustainable Development, which identified 17 goals. And goal number 16 is one that I think attracted all of us, which reaffirmed the critical importance of the rule of law, of the promotion of laws which protect people against discrimination, significant reduction of illicit financial and arms flows, reduction of corruption and bribery in all forms, and to that end, developing effective and transparent institutions, ensuring responsive, inclusive, and participatory decision-making at all levels, strengthening relevant national institutions by ensuring protection of fundamental freedoms, and international cooperation for building capacity at all levels. And particularly importance was given to curbing violence and having effective law enforcement to protect people against violence. I mean, I think all of us share this concern at the eruption of violence that we are witnessing in Bangladesh. It is a Bangladesh that I cannot recognize as being, you know, what we are. We have never been violent in this way. I mean, we were victims of violence in 71, but we have not, we have taken pride in the fact that between different ethnic groups, between different religions, we have had mutual respect and mutual understanding. And this is for the first time being challenged from certain quarters, where I must say that I have every sympathy that with all of us who are really being victims of this, because the image of Bangladesh, I mean, you say you're from Bangladesh, your passport is looked at much more closely by immigration. So this is unfortunately what a handful, a microscopic handful in Bangladesh have achieved for all of us. And I think we need, the answer to this is not to get into a mode of baiting the government. Government has failed, government is not doing what it should. What government should be doing is involving everybody in this. Terrorism, violence is not something that government itself can do, either to take the credit for it or, as it is doing now, taking the discredit for it. For heaven's sake, let's all get together. This is a threat to all of us. To the 170 million people of Bangladesh are threatened by those who are doing this. Someone who's called, as they say in today's Guardian, they say the two categories of targets are secular activists and minorities. And this negates our whole tradition. I mean, minorities have always felt safe in Bangladesh and have never thought of themselves as minorities. This minority-majority divide had, to a large extent, you know, been, they would try to exploit it pre-independence to create division on the basis of religion. We stood up and took this on frontally and defeated the communal forces. In 71, 16th of December, our victory day, I myself sort of celebrated by saying that, well, now communalism is a thing of the past, division, dividing people on the basis of religion, creating mutual distrust and prejudice. But now in 2016, to have today a Buddhist monk has been killed. Last week, some Hindu religious people had been killed. Not only that, academics, a professor in the University of Rajshahi, for no reason, waiting for a bus, found himself hacked to death. And then this is a particular pattern of hacking. Now, this kind of violence is not consistent with the goal of sustainable development. And I would urge that, you know, all of us should now think of the need for consensus, think of the need for a kind of non-confrontational relationship between different groups in society. And we must all identify this tolerance, creating a pluralism, and certainly getting away from the kind of politics which has been highly confrontational and divisive. After all, our greatest achievements before 71, in 71, and after 71 in getting rid of authoritarian people has been through united movement of all people, regardless of religion, regardless of ethnicity. And this is what we are risking by the kind of politics that is divisive. And exactly what you have just mentioned, democracy, working democracy, unadulterated democracy is imperative. And by democracy, I just don't mean the forms of an election, but a genuine election where people are given genuine choice. We have found that whenever we have done this, whenever we've managed to ensure this, including in 2008, and I'm paying a tribute to the government, 2008, I personally took this matter to court. We got the electoral list revised, and there were 10 million false votes which had to be cleared out. And after that, the election that was held, got the government that came in. We said post-liberation government, it was a victory for all of us. But we cannot understand what has happened from 2013 onwards, where we are having elections where 153 people get elected without a single vote having been cast. This is not us. I've been in Awami League for better part of my life. This is not the Awami League's tradition or history. I can see that my leader, Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujib, would be turning in his grave if he sees that Awami League has not got frightened about elections and that their unelected people are projecting themselves as elected representatives. This is a travesty which must stop. We must genuinely go to people. Country belongs to the people, and I'm quite sure that if we go to the people without money, and that's, so Paul would understand this, the amount of money that is being thrown at the electoral process to destroy it and to create elite groups, special interest groups, who want to control the state for their own self-serving purposes. This is a module which we are well known in countries which have damaged themselves, which undermine all the development and their prospects by destroying the electoral process, by disempowering people. In one word, the future lies with our people through empowerment, through increasing productivity, and through giving them a greater role in policy making and participatory governance, both at the local level, the village level, the union level, the district level, and the national level. And this now, and last point is, that there's a kind of misunderstanding about what partisanship is, what party rule means. See, it doesn't translate. There's a word which has been invented in our language, dolyokoron. Now I ask someone, please translate this. It's not partisanship, it's not politicization. They found a translation from it from some writing on Venezuela. The word is partiarchy. That means party above everything, party above nation, party above constitution, party proteges, to get every form of benefit, even to appointment, academic appointments, judicial appointments, political, of course, is there. And you get a nomination, you're declared elected. And these words will tell you a lot. There's a nomination, the trade in nominations. Nominations are sold for elections. You want to be a candidate, millions of takas have to be paid for that person to get a nomination, then he's elected. I mean, he doesn't need to go for an election. Now, why do people give so much money to be nominated? Because it's an investment. If you get a party position, whether it's even at the Union Council chairman, not to mention minister and MPs, it's the best business in town. It's the best kind of investment. Now, Sir Paul and our colleague from Africa will understand that this is not the kind of investment that will give us sustainable development. This is the kind of thing that will undermine both our economy and our democracy and will also encourage terrorism and all of the negative things. So answer is national consensus. I'm fairly confident that national consensus, if you take a head count, even of people who are here, they will tell you is we don't want this kind of divisiveness. We want a kind of unity and consensus on basics. We are all for free and fair election. I mean, I won't embarrass people by saying, anyone who's not for free and fair election, please raise your hand. I mean, no hand would be raised. This is the wonderful distinctive characteristic of people in Bangladesh, that everyone wants a genuine democracy. They don't want the forms of democracy and to play around with democracy, because we have paid very dearly for this right that we have got. I mean, we had close colleagues in the university who were killed 2 days before the surrender on 14th of December, 71. I mean, I still see them in front of me. I had thousands of students of mine who got killed in 71. This was not the kind of democracy for which they gave their lives. And I honestly feel that if we understand that sustainable development implies participation by people, economy and democracy, both by the people, for the people, and of the people, and not like what Professor Stiglitz had written in his book about some societies where it's government of the 1%, by the 1%, for the 1%. So it is, we must some really for the people, all of the people, of all religions, all ethnicities, village and urban, and this party is something that has to be understood. I have been a party member of the Awami League, which is the governing party, for more than 30 years. Closest to Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujib. We never dreamt of party conducting itself in this matter, of misappropriating, appropriating everything for the party. It has to stop.
Thank you. Dr. Rizvi, you are the current International Affairs Advisor to the Prime Minister of Bangladesh. What is your take on these current political concerns? How seriously is the government taking them, and what's it doing to try and solve them?
Thank you. I think it is very, very important both to address the question of violence and this supposed conflict between sustainability on the one side and democracy on the other. You know, all of us abhor what has recently happened. Day before yesterday, I saw a figure. The type of violence I'm talking about is one, people who have been killed either because they're a minority or for expressing views with others have disagreed. I mean, it is absolutely abhorrent, and there is no two way of looking at it. There can be no compromise with freedom of expression. That said, I think we need to put this violence into some context. If you compare what is happening in Bangladesh with all the other countries, in the region and beyond the region, I think we will have to understand that this violence is absolutely of a microscopic nature. I am not underestimating, nor am I lessening my abhorrence for what is happening. Nor am I saying the government has to sit back It must do everything possible to curb that. So there is no question about it. But I would urge everybody to understand, if you look at the numbers of people being killed in Bangladesh and killed elsewhere, it is a small number. But in violence, one is too many. So as soon as you have one person killed, it is one too many. Therefore, there is no way of saying few is okay and more would be less justifiable. Second thing about sustainability and democracy, I think this whole argument that sustainability and growth should somehow forsake, it cannot. These are integral. You cannot do one without the other. And that is why the government's focus, the way it has achieved sustainability, is through inclusive growth. Let me point out a few things which are not very well known. We have already talked about women's empowerment in Bangladesh. It was a part of what I had earlier said. Look at those who are most disabled in terms of economics, poverty, health, etc. And in that, women were at the bottom of the pile. We focused on women through education, through credit, through employment, so that they could come up. Similarly, to create a stable society, everybody needs to have a stake. Everybody needs to be looked after. Bangladesh is the only country in the world with a comparable level of per capita income, where we have a social safety net, means tested. It is means tested, but social safety net, where no poor person today is going to starve. Yes, there are various cases. Anybody who is vulnerable comes under that net. Again, we have, again, I use the word carefully because these are all selective. Social safety net is means tested. Similarly, we have a universal basic health care. I use the word basic. We have 18,000 clinics, community clinics, which provides health care and reaches virtually everyone free of cost. Now, this is how you create stakes and how you create stability. Dr. Hossain quite rightly said, and this is one of the great miracles of Bangladesh. In 1970, just before our independence, every year we were short of food. With a population of 70 million, we could not feed ourselves. It was some years, it was ship to mouth. If the ship arrived late, there was starvation. Today we have a population of nearly 156 million. We have tripled our, there is a surplus of food, and nobody today goes without food in Bangladesh. These did not happen by chance. These happened, as I said earlier on, these are targeted policies, policy of rural electrification, which enabled the ability to bring in irrigation, tough policy choices when in the heat, in the height of the summer, when the heat was intensive, power grid, because then there was not enough power, power grids were shifted to the rural areas so that irrigation could take place. And we have had now 7-8 years of bumper crops. So it is true that Bangladesh is suffering from democratic deficit. There is no question about that. And these are the challenges. But these challenges do not demean or undermine the achievements. And last point I want to make is that we must compare Bangladesh not in terms of some ideal, but in the real world. And in the real world, Bangladesh has achieved, its achievements are phenomenal. Yes, I will say there is more accountability needed, absolutely. But you ask that question, why is it that the political institutions are so weak? It is so weak because since
independence, more than half the period has been under military rule, where parliament, judiciary, civil service, everything has been deinstitutionalized and weakened. Political parties have been weakened. We need to rebuild them. Under authoritarian rule, presidential forms of government, strong, so-called strong men have been able to make decisions on their own. Constraints on the executives have been removed. So a parliamentary system of government now is slowly needs to claw back. No, I'm not saying it is clawing back. There has to be restraint on them. Control has to be exercised over them. But like everywhere else, including Britain, parliamentary forms of governments are becoming much more executive forms of government. These are the problems. These are absolute problems. They will need to be addressed. But I would again and again say, we need to put this in context and not judge Bangladesh in terms of some ideal.
Thank you. Professor Sir Paul, moving forwards from now, what would be your advice for Bangladesh so that its achievements in economic growth and in human development can be sustained in the long run?
Yes, I very much agree that the battle is going to be between the power of parliament and the power of an executive head. You know, what we know now from quite a lot of evidence is that parliamentary systems are actually superior to presidential systems.
Absolutely.
And now, we also know that anything to do with elections is a struggle. The conduct of elections, you know, you can hold elections anywhere. You can hold them in the middle of violent conflict in Afghanistan, in the middle of a war in Iraq, you can hold elections. What you can't do is build the checks and balances which ensure that the process of an election is honest. One of my latest pieces of work has been to study something over 700 elections around the world, and about 30% of them are seriously flawed. And then we look to see, does that matter for economic performance? And unsurprisingly, you know, it does matter. That where the elections are honest, they work. Governments that mess up the economy tend to lose the election. Where the elections are contaminated, then there is no relationship between what a government does and whether it gets re-elected, because it's manipulating the process. And so the struggle everywhere, not just in Bangladesh, there's nothing unique about Bangladesh here, the struggle everywhere is for decent conduct of election processes, but you start from the right structure, you start from a parliamentary system. The problem across Africa is that they don't start from a parliamentary system, they start from presidential systems. And that concentrates far too much power in one person. And then it's the luck of the draw, you know. So you start from the right structure. As you say, that's been contaminated over the years by periods of military rule where, by its very nature, there are no checks and balances whatsoever. And so you're fighting to rebuild a system of parliamentary checks and balances on power. That is a struggle. Bangladesh is not unique in that, but you start with the right structure in which to have that struggle. Across Africa, the struggle's there, but they don't start with the right political structure. You know? And I should say, contaminated elections are by no means unique to South Asia. I mean, you know, look at North America. These are struggles everywhere, and they're continuous battles. They're never wars which are won. They're battles which are fought. You know, I should say I'd forgotten all about the birth of Bangladesh in 1971, and that struggle with students being killed, and
I was a student here in 1971, and I remember feeling that that's not just their struggle, it's my struggle. And I joined, I built a little group that was trying to provide books for Bangladesh. And I remember driving around the country collecting books to restock the libraries of Bangladesh. We all sensed that this was a global struggle, and we celebrated that, thank goodness, Bangladesh had escaped from the clutches of a terrible militarized rule from Pakistan. And, you know, I still celebrate that. Bangladesh is a success because you escaped from those clutches. And if you look at the counterfactual, if you look at the counterfactual, would you rather be part of Pakistan? I think the answer is no, you wouldn't. Thank you.
Thank you. We're going to open up now to questions from the audience. If you would like to ask a question, please raise your hand up high and wait for the microphone to be brought round to you. Can we please start with a question from the gentleman in the blue shirt on the second row? Just wait for the microphone. Thanks.
Thank you. Very nice discussions. As so far I follow from Dr. Kamal Hossain and Professor Paul, came out that democracy is important. Bangladesh is doing well. Progress very well, index is high, economic growth is high, per capita income is reached, increased, everything is fine. However, the question is, the democracy is not properly functioning there. The body who maintain that, ensures that, proper election and proper democracy, election commission is not properly functioning. Not only that, transparency is also important. The body, another constitutional body like election anti-corruption commission, that also ensures transparency. That is not also functioning properly. I want to have comments from Dr. Rizvi, please.
Thank you. If I may. See, nobody would agree with you. This is the point I was making, that institutions have been emaciated over a period of time under the military rule. And as Sir Paul just mentioned, that these institutions have to be strengthened. Just to say, because the election commission doesn't work, let's abolish it, will not do. If you remember in India, today we cite India as the finest example of democracy, not only in the developing world, but in the whole world. Until Justice Session became the chief of election commission, its performance was dismal. He's built it up. So what we need to do is to strengthen and build election commission, not undermine it. It is there, it will take time. Perhaps it is slower than we would all like, including me, but it is there. The other thing, again, to immediately point out to say that, you know, this institution doesn't work. For instance, there is not one, but number of institutions we have built in the last few years. We have created a national integrity strategy to create greater transparency and accountability. The anti-corruption commission that you mentioned, its function, its performance has been mixed. We have a new chairman. Let's see whether he is able to raise it. In addition, we have right to information, which enables information is at the end of the day the source of our power. We have a human rights commission. These are still fledgling. We have the head of the most important human rights organization in Bangladesh sitting in this room. They are upholding this, and they are finding room within this space of this democratic society. Not often very successfully, because there are impediments. But what we have to say is we are moving in the right direction. Sadly, not as fast as we would like. And again, I urge you to compare apples with apples in the real world situation and not some ideal.
Thank you very much. Can we go, please, to the next question from...
Next was actually me.
Sorry?
Can I ask a question? Or?
Go ahead.
Sorry.
Go ahead, please.
I got three questions. One is for Dr. Kamal Hossain. And the question is, do you think that the free and fair election is the only way to making sure that democracy is working in Bangladesh? Because in past, we found that there was free and fair election, question mark from the opposition party, obviously, but there was free and fair election, but then the opposition party didn't participate in the parliament, they made violence in the street, economies has been destroyed, strikes have been called day after day, and economies has been destroyed. So what's the benefit of the free and fair election? Is that the only way to making sure that government is working? My second question is to Dr. Gowher Rizvi. How is there any plan or how the government is planning to making sure that government utilize the skilled workforce around the, in mainly Bangladesh, you know, from home and abroad, to achieve the 2041, you know, the developed countries objective. And number three question to you as well, Dr. Gowher Rizvi, is there any plan of the government to reform the civil service? And when I say reform, I'm just indicating on the recruitment process and the system, because I think the civil service, what we are having now, is not good enough to achieve the 2041, the developed countries objective. Thank you.
Thank you. Could I ask everyone to please keep their questions brief so we can get through as many as possible? Dr. Hossain.
Sorry. Yes, no, I think you put a question which is very pertinent. If you are to run democracy, is there any substitute for free and fair elections? Now, my point is, my opinion is not as important as the fact that this is what the Constitution has provided. And on this point, I think if you took any kind of referendum, I almost think there would be 100% minus maybe, you know, some bigoted right-wing parties who don't believe in democracy. Barring this, I think there's nobody in Bangladesh, even the poorest person in the village, is for elections and for free and fair elections. The sad part is that we've seen even elections at the union level being damaged in a way that is very alarming. And for all of us who care for the country, and it really doesn't matter who's governing at the center, but the question is, at the grassroots, if we start damaging institutions, dividing even families by this partyization, party elections at the local level is outrageous, absolutely outrageous. I mean, I have conducted elections. I was the voting representative for Sheikh Mujib in the capital city. It's a wonderful election. Now, you've all heard about the 1970 election. Billions of takas had come against us. And I had volunteers, young students. We went from house to house. And I said, look, they're saying that if you vote for regional autonomy, Islam will be destroyed. And they had put posters all over the walls. And we literally went with these thousands of student volunteers, house to house. And you know, elderly people who normally are prone to being, you know, religious and so on, we said, look, how is Islam going to be destroyed if you get your rights? We are 56% of the people, and we don't get more than 30% of the budget, we don't get more than 25% of the jobs and so on. So believe me, we had a thumping victory in 1979. Sorry, 70, in 1970. Then, you know, when we had our movement against the military, because you were talking about the military thing, someone talked about the military. Doha talked about the military. Now, General Irshad is a military man, right? Now, I have not understood what he is doing in Bangladesh or in Bangladesh political system. He is a member of the, is he a member of the government? Perhaps he's special envoy. For whom is he envoy to, and what is the terms of reference? I mean, maybe I'll have to send a right to information notice to you to tell us what has a special envoy he does and what we are paying him for. Now, therefore, what is the substitute for election? I mean, I would very much like to, you know, I hope from the floor, if you have any good suggestion of how you can replace free and fair elections as a mode of people exercising choice to designate their representative at union, at district, at thana, and at the central level. It would be very good to know that. Now, I can tell you that free elections can be made free if you have from those who are at the moment in power or who were in power previously to control the money that they throw at the electoral process. It is the destruction of elections. Two things have destroyed elections. There are others, but these are the two principal ones. One is to have a subservient election commission. It has been my misfortune to engage with every election commission for as long as I can remember, from 70 onwards. When we've had a good election commission, as in 1970, excellent election. Even in 2008, the beneficiary of which is the present government, we had a good election. No one will say it was not a good election. And the person who was then chief election commissioner, when he was leaving, left a draft law that please try to constitute the next election commission following this new law. I personally took the law to the then president. I said, look, they've held a good election in 2008. All they're asking for is to have the next election commission constituted according to this law. And the law is an excellent law, consultation among everybody, three candidates being identified in that way, and then somebody being appointed. But that law was just totally ignored. There is no such law in place. The same question has come up in regard to appointment of judges. It has come up with regard to election commission. Now, why do we want to have unfettered discretion in the hands of the executive to nominate the election commission, which is in fact going to have to be an umpire between competing parties, including the incumbent party? Now, I mean, I'm afraid that this is where I would beg Gowher as an advisor to the Prime Minister. Now, I don't have access, and one day and there was a time when I used to be able to walk in and give advice, but I don't think I would try to do that now. But my best effort is to say, Gowher, please explain that this is not something that is to anybody's benefit. To say that free election is not, what is the answer? Free election.
I'm not saying that free election is not the, obviously we need free.
No, I sympathize with you. No, I sympathize with you because yes, what is being called an election today is not an election.
But what's happening after the election, what we have seen in the past, like the violence, okay. And you know, the strikes have been called day after day, economies have been destroyed, which is not the part of the
election. Sure, no, but you see, that's my point. I mean, this is, I hope through this discussion here, we'll come up with some ideas of how you think governance can be improved. If you think elections, the way elections are being done now is destructive, both the process itself, what it yields, and what the after effects are, agreed. But what then is the answer? I mean, I'd very much welcome your answers. And, you know, I think Gowher said something about ideal. But there is a constitution. I mean, do you accept the constitution or do you not? It bears the signature of Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, number one. All the founding fathers, that's held in the museum. I said, please, let's go to the museum and look at it. If there is a constitution and we believe in it, it says power belongs to the people, can only be exercised by their elected representative. Election chapter says elections must be free and fair. Election commission must be neutral. Now, do you or do you not accept all that? These are not ideals. These are constitutional provisions.
Sorry, I ought to say a word about ideal. When I said it was ideal, it was not, these are the ideals we believe in. And before the start of the meeting, I was telling somebody that in 1975, learned what little politics I learned was at Dr. Hussain's feet. And therefore, everything you have said, I totally agree with you. There's no disagreement. Like you, I agree that there is no alternative to an election, but while election is necessary, it is not a sufficient condition. It requires other things, values, ethos, practices, beliefs, which also has to be strengthened along the process without. Now, just since Dr. Hossain is here, the current practice for election, the appointment of election commission is drawn straight out of the 1972 constitution, which was solely your own handicraft. And it is by far the best thing that we have. Military rulers had mutilated that constitution. One of the good news is we have been largely able to restore that constitution. I say largely, there are one or two areas where we didn't go as far as the 1972 constitution went. So we need to strengthen. But where an important change has been made, but this is not working itself out properly. For instance, the Constitution says the Prime Minister will suggest names to the President for the appointment of the Election Commission. The current Prime Minister made an innovation without changing the Constitution. She voluntarily gave up her right to nominate the members of Parliament, and she constituted a search committee with the President as the head. And the President did convene all the party leaders and asked them for their advice. So the innovation was good, but unfortunately, it didn't produce the result that many of us were hoping for. Now, going back to your second and third question about sustainable, can Bangladesh achieve sustainable development goals? You see, we had doubts about will we ever reach Millennium Development Goals, and Bangladesh was one of the top performers when it came to it. Same thing with sustainable development goals. Right from day one, we have started working. Every fortnight, all the secretaries are assembled together. One of our secretaries is sitting right there. She was also present at that meeting. Every fortnight we meet to review sustainable development goals. And what we have also done it is made this as a part of the performance appraisal of the secretaries. So the realization of sustainable development goal is made a part of their contract, and it is it will be used in their evaluation whether they are a successful secretary or not. Civil service, yes, a very important thing. And I, like it more than anybody else, I suspect in this room, is very frustrated because 5-6 years ago, I had the privilege of being a part of drafting of the Civil Service Act. It is done, it has taken into account appointments, promotions, training, four key things. Why it has not yet been enacted, I don't know. And the failure to enact the Civil Service Act is at the root of politicization of the civil service. So unless we can enact that act, I suspect that shortcoming will remain.
Thank you. We can go first to the question from that lady with the red book on the front row.
Hi, thank you for being here and for your discussion. So, coming from an environmental background and hearing about Bangladesh being one of the most vulnerable countries to climate change, the rising sea levels and extreme flooding events happening every year, how is the government preparing to respond to that? Because the SDGs are very wide, but this is like a specific climate issue that Bangladesh is very vulnerable to.
Shall I address? Thank you very, very much. As you said, Bangladesh is what is being described as the frontline state in global warming. There are two parts to this question. Rather, the answer is in two parts. One is Bangladesh, knowing how vulnerable we are to this, we have been ahead of others, both in adaptation and mitigation of global warming. There have been a lot of promises made, most recently in Paris, of about the huge sums of money that the international community is going to commit. So far, we have not seen it. However, we have Bangladesh, at its own initiative, has created a climate adaptation and mitigation fund, and a lot of work has taken place. And this also links up with our research in agriculture. How can we grow, for instance, rice in saline water areas? How can we grow better quality rice in arid area? So these things are also being done to supplement the straightforward work that of mitigation and adaptation.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to chip in before we head to the next question? Oh, great. We'll go to the question on the third row.
Thank you very much. It's been an absolutely gorgeous discussion between the four panelists, and I think one of the key themes and principles that came across through everybody's discussions was the importance and the value of people. Because when you look at the opening remarks from Dr. Kamal Hossain, it was all about democratic empowerment of people. Sir Paul Collier's, my biggest takeaway from the day is that Bangladesh is the antithesis of Saudi Arabia, the entire theological debate of a people's republic of Bangladesh versus Islamic republics elsewhere. Dr. Gowher Rizvi again touched on it around social collaborative governance. Professor Nkube also spoke about raising human productivity. My question is purely economics. It's like we've seen the economic development model of Bangladesh. It's about remittances and exporting people. But what does the government need to do and plan for in order to make that model sustainable, i.e. move to the higher tiers, i.e. exporting white-collar workers and then repatriating them back into the country? So what are the things the government is already doing and looking forward to do in the next few years in order to be able to step up? Thank you.
Thank you. Professor Sapul, Professor Nkube.
I think my colleagues from Bangladesh can be more specific on that in terms of the policies on the ground. But what we know is that in order to sustain the path, the trajectory of harnessing human potential, is that we must invest in skills. So making sure that the education system is such that you maximize the potential for those who end up in universities and building the technical skills through another branch should be followed. I can foresee a system where the Bangladesh could invest more in technical education, vocational technical education, let's say after the O level, the kind of 16 years old education level, and then those others can branch into A level and then eventually into university. So building technical vocational education institutions is pretty much key. But also, if you're going to do that, you have to make sure that you take on both what you call a supply side and the demand side approach. I'm an economist, so these kind of terms come easily, I apologize. So what I mean by that is that you want companies, the private sector, to be a part of the training ecosystem of these youth. It's very important. You also want your parastatals to be involved, whether it's rail, electricity company, they need to be involved in this. So to me, it's about training, building skills. Of course, it's one part, but it's a very critical part. And if you want a model to copy, I have to say, you have to copy the Germans. In my view, they still have the best system that balances academia and vocational training, and so does Switzerland. If you're looking further south, I would say, look at what Mauritius is doing, believe it or not, but also what China has done. So there are a few models to copy in terms of that system.
Yeah. Thank you. Well, I think that engine of industrialization works, eventually works for ordinary people. It takes time. China is a good example. That first you go through a phase where you just create jobs, 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 jobs. They're not very good jobs. But at some stage, the labor market starts to tighten. And then you go through a phase where wages really start to rise. That's what happened in China. And as wages start to rise, then firms are forced to move up a ladder of sophistication. China's got an awful lot of people to absorb, so it took a long time for that. It was much faster in a little place like Mauritius, which broke in at about the same time that Bangladesh broke in. But in Mauritius, you've only got to deal with, you know, 1 or 2 million people. And so very quickly, Mauritius hit the point where full employment, wages started to rise, and up the ladder of sophistication, Mauritius went exactly the point that Matuli made, that there was a lot of training. They had to train. And now Mauritius is up there at about $15,000 a year, you know. So it works, but it works in these phases where first you've got to get to a tighter labor market. Bangladesh isn't there yet. There's a lot of people to employ.
Thank you. I think we've got time for one more quick question.
Thank you, Robert, and the distinguished panelists, audience. I'm part of the bureaucracy of Bangladesh. There are two interesting elements came that this bureaucracy will not deliver. You know, that was the apprehension of the gentleman. But that bureaucracy, immediately after the independence of Bangladesh, there was not a good number of bureaucrats, not quality, numbers. Basically, the administration was non-existent. But bureaucracy helped the government to deliver. In 2008, the election, government in power with the people's mandate, the same argument came, how the Prime Minister will implement the Vision 2021 to make Bangladesh a middle-income country. What is the bureaucracy? This bureaucracy, corrupt, inefficient, they will not deliver. But they did. In 2041, there is another vision for a kind of a higher ambition, a developed economy like UK. Will it be possible by the same bureaucracy? I will not survive more than 3 months in bureaucracy, but I tell you, this bureaucracy will deliver. The reason is, if the government has a mandate, if you have the right political leadership, and if that leadership has a vision and the commitment. If you see that for 2021, Bangladesh is the best achiever of Millennium Development Goal among 49 LDC countries, least developed countries. We are the best. So SDG target is elimination of poverty by 2030. We are almost eliminating poverty already. So our leadership has a vision of 2041 to make the country developed. So what are the fundamental requirements? Your policy prescriptions. We have a very strong, very doable, long-term plan, perspective plan. We transform the whole economy through structural planning. And we did it, and we'll do it. Government gave huge emphasis on infrastructure development. And I tell you a very interesting story. And I claim, Robert, as ambassador of Bangladesh, that Bangladesh is the only country among 49 least developed countries created a very vibrant private sector to take over the market to determine what should be the market behave in terms of inclusiveness, in terms of delivery, welfare, and development. We have created a very strong entrepreneurial class. We are not stuck to 5 or 10 families. We have hundreds of families who are billionaires in Bangladesh. You may not find in Africa. You may not find in many other countries. So this government, right or wrong, it has a lot of challenges, a lot of socioeconomic problems, but the private sector is taking over. This government, or the leadership, created an ambition of betterment, and people believed in the leadership, and they are taking over in partnership with the government. I'm absolutely positive you'll see and enjoy the future development of Bangladesh. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll go for one final question from the lady in the front row.
Thank you very much. How has the influence of radical Islam affected Bangladesh? And what action has government taken to combat this issue and should take in the future and present? Thank you. I would like to address this question to Dr. Hossain.
No, I think this again is, at this point in time, a very pertinent question, because we had, from the 50s, a a consistent effort to promote a political system where religion could be kept out of politics. In 1954, the election, Awami Muslim League dropped the word Muslim from its title and became Awami League. And there was, previous to that, election on the basis of religious electorates, separate electorates for Muslims, separate electorates for other religions. In 1954, mind you, the election lists were combined and there was joint electorate. And what was then the Muslim League, which was a communal party, was decimated in 1954. So throughout the 60s, every effort was being made to re-inject, the military, mind you, the Pakistan military tried to re-inject religion into politics. Women were told you can't have a red, you know, teep. You couldn't listen to Rabindranath Tagore because he's not a Muslim, and so on. And I tell you that the people of Bangladesh, who are overwhelmingly Muslims, 80% in those days, 85% now, over 90%, rejected this. And the 1970 elections, to me, is an eye-opener, because the Pakistanis launched a whole campaign on the basis of stirring up this religious frenzy, that if you vote for regional autonomy, which were our legitimate demand, Hindus will take over, Muslims will be completely decimated, and so on. But even people in the villages made a rational choice, and the result is independent Bangladesh. So when we were making the constitution, King Faisal asked me, why did you make a secular constitution? So my answer was, look, normally I would not, subject myself to a viva voce of this kind, but since you are sort of a special position in Islam, I'll tell you. I said, look, what is religion when it's brought into politics? It leads to communal riots, people being killed. Look at Pakistan today. And it was very interesting when someone said about what do Pakistanis think now. In the early days, 70 to 75, Pakistanis would come and say, how do you like independence? You have famine now. Yeah. All right, so one had to be modest and say, we have our problems and so on. Today, young MPs from Pakistan come to me and said, you are so fortunate that you got out when you did. Yeah. You don't know what kind of a hell we are living in. So, this is this. And mind you, this is the impact of religion. Religion. You'll see every Friday, in some mosque or the other, bomb blasts. In Lahore, in Karachi, in Peshawar. And the casualties are 150 and or more. Now, this is what I explained to King Faisal. And, it was an hour and a half that I harangued him. Not harangued him, but submitted to him these rational arguments and said, for that is the reason why. Let us keep religion and out of politics. We'll practice our religion. We have freedom of religion guaranteed in the constitution. See, those who are opposed to us campaigned throughout the Middle East that locks are hanging on mosques. So, of course, when people came, I remember the present Amir of Kuwait came to Bangladesh. I took him to the mosque on a Friday. And he couldn't get in because there was such a crowd of people in the central mosque. So when he came out, I said, did you see any mosque, any lock hanging on the mosque? He laughed. He said, I understand what you're driving at. So my point is, we are all good Muslims. We all practice it as we think best. But no Muslim in Bangladesh will feel that his religion is under any kind of threat. We're 90%. So to try and inject religion into our political life is totally misguided, misconceived. And some kind of pressure is being put from some quarters where, suddenly we've had a thing brought in the 15th Amendment. This Islam is the state religion. I honestly do not understand what that means. And I won't embarrass Gowher by, asking him to explain what that is, because I'm sure he doesn't know how it came and where it came from. And if any one of you know where it came from, let me know. Because it certainly didn't come from even within the party, because I discussed with the party 15-member committee that, we've managed to now have the secular principle restored by the court decision. So this, in fact, had been introduced by General Irshad. Islam is the state religion. He imported it from Pakistan when he was absolutely sinking. And so he thought this would be a kind of log which he could hold on to and float. But it didn't help him. He sank. So I said, why in 2012, 13, when was it, the 15th Amendment? Why was this brought in? If any one of you would have any idea about this, I'd very much like to hear it. In Bangladesh, I have asked everyone, including leading members of the Army League, where did this come from? And quite frankly, I asked Gowher, where did this come from?
Dr. Rizvi, quickly.
Well, I can share exactly what happened. It did not come in from anywhere, it was already there. General Ershad had introduced this, and our feeling, which is exactly the same thing, that Bangladesh's survival other than a secular state is impossible.
Yeah, yeah.
Absolutely impossible. So it is for its survival, we need that. But this had already been brought in. And there was a lot of us in the room. There was a small group. But in that small group, lot of us, all argued that this should be eliminated. Eliminated because this was not in the original 1973 constitution. But the argument made then was this. I'm just sharing without saying. The argument was, if you remove, in the 40 years since 1973, lot of transformation in the society has taken place. And if we remove this right now, there will be a lot of agitation on the streets, and the government's reform agenda might get sidetracked. And therefore, let us go step by step. And one of the other things that was done along with it was immediately another phrase was added to the thing. Islam is the state religion. All other religions have equal freedom status, blah, blah, blah. So that was, I agree with you, it is totally unsatisfactory. But that was, you wanted to know how it happened. And since I was there, I'm happy to share with you.
Good. Thank you very much. Sometime you'll tell me who said what.
No, I can tell you that. I can tell you that.
Sure, not now.
Thank you very much. I'm afraid that's all that we have time for this afternoon. Could I please ask you all to remain seated whilst our guests leave the chamber? And could you join me in thanking once again Professor Nakube, who's had to run off to catch a flight. Dr. Rizvi. Professor Paul Collier. And Dr. Hossain, thank you.